I'm Derek Walker. I'm the pastor of the Oxford Bible Church. And today we're continuing our series on the rapture. And it's entitled Rapture Ready. Are you ready for the rapture? I'm going to tell you all about the rapture, what's going to happen, and how it affects our lives now. How can we be ready for it? What's going to happen? And I want to get you ready for takeoff. Because we've seen so far in this series that Jesus will come for his church and he will take us to be with him. And we will then stand before his judgment seat and we will be judged for our eternal rewards. And we've seen that the signs of the times all show that the rapture is close, even in our lifetime. What is the rapture? Let me give you a definition of it. The rapture is the coming of Christ for the church, in which he instantly catches up all living believers to meet him in the air, and then translates them into, and he will translate those who are alive into immortal bodies without experiencing death. Praise God. And so when Jesus comes, all who are in the church who have died, they will be resurrected. And we who are alive, we will be changed and given immortal bodies, and we will all rise together and meet the Lord in the air. Praise God. And we've seen that the teaching of Jesus on the rapture. Jesus said that he would come as a thief in the night. Now, other scriptures talk about Jesus coming in power and glory, and he will manifest himself to the whole world. But Jesus also describes a different phase of his coming where he will come, as it were, secretly. He won't manifest himself to the whole world. He will come as a thief in the night. He will come to take something and go again. And the world will just think a thief has come in the night. You see, a thief doesn't manifest himself to everyone in the house. He comes and he goes. He has something to do. He has something to take, and then he goes again. Jesus says he will come as a thief in the night. Let's read what Jesus says, shall we? In Matthew 24, from verse 39. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field. One will be taken, and the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill. One will be taken, and the other left. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. You see, nobody knows when the rapture is going to happen. It's going to happen suddenly. God isn't going to announce from heaven, the rapture will be in 10 days. No, it will happen in a twinkling of an eye, without warning. And he says, but know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, you see, he's talking about himself as the thief. If he had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. Jesus is coming, but you don't know when he's coming. So you've got to stay ready. You've got to stay watchful all the time, because Jesus could come at any time. Hallelujah. And when he comes as a thief in the night. Now, isn't this a strange expression? But he says this on many occasions. Revelation 3:3, he warns unbelievers in the church. He says, therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know what hour I come upon you. Revelation 16:15 says, behold, I am coming as a thief. Blessed is he who watches. Blessed is the one who's ready and then goes to be with the Lord in the rapture. 2 Peter 3:10 says, the day of the Lord, the tribulation, will come as a thief in the night. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 2 and 3 says, the day of the Lord, that's a name for the tribulation, the last 7 years of history that are described in the book of Revelation, the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. In other words, it will happen suddenly. It will be a total surprise to the world. The Lord will come as a thief in the night and take his people to be with him. And then the day of the Lord, the tribulation, will begin. And this is how it will happen. It says, for when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them. That's the tribulation. Everything will seem to be fine. And then suddenly millions of believers will disappear. And then sudden destruction comes upon the world as labor pains upon a pregnant woman. Yes, There is a wonderful baby to be born. The kingdom of God is to be born on the earth. But before that birth can happen, just before, there are labor pains as the kingdom of God clashes with the kingdom of darkness. And those labor pains is the tribulation. And so it says, they shall not escape. It will be a terrible time upon the earth. And so this phrase, the thief in the night, is the key phrase for the rapture. He comes in the night. The world will be in darkness. I want you to notice a thief does not come to take over the house. He comes to take the precious things from the house. He comes secretly. He doesn't manifest himself to those who are sleeping. They're sleeping, and he comes and he goes. He comes and goes unseen. And he will only appear to believers because he has come to take the believers from the house of this world. Hebrews 9:28 says, Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time. I want you to notice, he will not appear to everyone this second time when he comes in the rapture. He only appears to those who wait for him, who are ready. And praise God, he comes for our salvation. He's going to save us. He's going to resurrect us in the rapture. Praise God, Hebrews 9:28. So Jesus will come to take something from the world, and he will go again, and the darkness won't see him. All they will know is that millions, even billions, will disappear. Yes, he comes to take the precious things from the earth. Who are the precious jewels? It's the believers. Praise God. Yes, to the world, it will look like a thief has come, but he's not really a thief because he's only coming to take what is his. Yes, we've been bought with the blood of Jesus. We belong to Jesus. We're in the world, but we're not of the world. The world doesn't own us. He owns us, and he's coming to take us. But to the world, it will seem as if a thief has come. Hallelujah. Well, it also means, the thief in the night means his coming will be sudden and unannounced. A thief doesn't tell you when he's about to come. So Jesus is going to come suddenly. And that means the rapture is imminent. It could happen at any time. It could happen as you're watching this program. You know, if I suddenly disappear as you're watching in a few minutes, that's because I've left in the rapture. Well, and if you're still watching, that means you haven't gone. Well, you need to repent. Well, anyway, it's the last message of the Bible. Jesus is coming quickly. It's imminent. Anytime. Revelation 22:7 says, Jesus says, behold, listen, I am coming quickly. Behold, verse 12, I'm coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according to his work. Yes, the first thing that will happen, once you're raptured, Jesus is coming. It will all happen suddenly, in the twinkling of an eye, and then you will stand before Jesus, and he will judge you. You'll give an account for your life and all that you've done, and you will be rewarded by him according to your work. Revelation 22:20 says, he who testifies to these things says, surely I am coming quickly. Amen. That's Jesus' last message in the Bible. He's coming soon. Praise God. And so we've got to stay ready. He could come any time, any time. Even as you're watching the program, he could come. Have a look in Luke 21. It talks about that we must always stay ready. That's why Jesus hasn't given us the date, because then we wouldn't feel the need to be ready. But if we don't know when he's coming, he could come any time, then we've got to stay ready all the time. Luke 21:34, he says, take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and the cares of this life, and that day, the day of the Lord, the tribulation, come on you unexpectedly. For it will come as a snare, as a trap that will suddenly close on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. And it's talking about earth dwellers, people who don't belong to the Lord. Their heart is on the earth and on the world. And the tribulation will snap tight on these people. He says, watch therefore and pray always that you be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass. Hallelujah, and stand before the Son of Man. You see, these verses describe a time of judgment and wrath called the tribulation, the day of the Lord that is coming upon the whole earth. And Jesus said that only the true believers will be counted worthy to escape They will escape this time of tribulation, and instead of going through it, they will stand resurrected before the Son of Man. Hallelujah. Jesus is teaching what we call a pre-tribulation rapture here, which means the rapture happens before the tribulation. Some people believe in a mid-tribulation or a post-tribulation rapture, but here the teaching of the Bible is consistent that it will happen before the tribulation. Yes, we're all facing tribulations in our life on this earth. We're not talking about that. But the tribulation is a special time of tribulation where evil comes to its fullness under the Antichrist and God starts judging and pouring out his wrath in increasing severity upon the earth. He's still saving souls, but it is a time of judgment upon this earth. And it will be far worse than anything that's been experienced until this time. And trust me, you do not want to be in that. Well, as we look at the teaching of Paul on the rapture, we will also see that he teaches a pre-tribulation rapture. And we're going to look particularly now at Paul's teaching. Let's start with 1 Thessalonians 1, 9 and 10. It says, "They themselves declare concerning us what manner of entry we had to you and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven." He's describing Christians here, true believers. They've turned to the living God from idols and they are waiting now expectantly for his Son from heaven. Hallelujah. Whom he raised from the dead. Even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. I want you to notice that phrase. Jesus is coming. We're to expect, we're to confidently expect him to come again because he is coming. And just as God raised Jesus from the dead, so he is coming to raise us from the dead. Hallelujah. And to rapture us. And he comes to deliver us from the wrath to come. You see, what's the wrath to come? It's the tribulation, which is a time of wrath and judgment that is coming upon the earth. And when Jesus returns, he comes to save us from this time of wrath. Now, it's not talking about hell here because Jesus has already delivered us from hell. Praise God. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you've moved from darkness to light. You've moved from judgment, hallelujah, into grace. You've been delivered from hell, but when Jesus comes again, he comes to deliver you from wrath. It's the wrath of the tribulation time. And so Jesus will come and deliver us from the tribulation. Hallelujah. Romans 8:1 says, there's no condemnation of judgment for those in Christ. Romans 5:9 says, much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved. Hallelujah. We've been saved from the wrath of hell, but we shall also be saved from wrath through him, from the tribulation. Revelation 3:10 says, because Jesus says, because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. I want you to notice that he's talking about a special hour, a future time of terrible tribulation that will come upon the whole earth. And he says, I will keep you. Not just from the trial, he says, I will keep you from the hour of trial. I'll keep you from that whole time period of the tribulation. This is his promise to believers. How is he going to do it? Read the next verse, verse 11. Behold, I am coming quickly. Hallelujah. He's coming to take us to be with him in the rapture, and we will be delivered from that whole time of trial that is coming on the earth. He says, hold fast what you have, that no one take your crown. He says, I'm coming and I'm going to reward you when I come. Don't let anyone take your crown. Fulfill your work. Fulfill your ministry. Be faithful. That's what he's saying. And so, because the tribulation is a time of wrath, and because believers have been delivered from the wrath and the judgment of God, we do not belong to that tribulation time, and God is going to rescue us from it before it starts. Before he can pour out his judgment, he is going to take us out. Hallelujah. And this agrees with what Jesus teaches on the rapture because he compared it to the days of Noah and Lot. And in both cases, before those terrible judgments fell down, the flood of Noah's time and the fire and brimstone of Lot's time, what did God do? He removed the believers. Noah was removed into the ark and the believers disappeared, you see. And then the judgment came down. And in the same way, the angels took Lot out of Sodom, and then the judgment came down. And so the angels are going to take us out of here, and then the judgment of the tribulation is going to come down. We are going to disappear, as it were, into the ark. And as the ark rose above the waters of judgment, and the believers were safe above the judgment, so we will be lifted up above the judgment. Hallelujah. And we will be saved before the judgment is poured out. That's what Jesus is saying. Matthew 24:36, he says, "But of that day and hour, no one knows," he says. Verse 37, "But as the days of Noah were, so will the days of the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating, drinking, marrying, given in marriage, until the day Noah entered the ark." There's the believers removed before the judgment. "And they did not know until the flood came." The very day Noah was put in the ark and the door was shut, then the flood came down. The very moment the believers are raptured, then the tribulation will begin. And he says, the world didn't know until the flood came and took them all away. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field, one taken and the other left. Watch, he says, for you do not know the hour your Lord is coming. You see, as in the days of Noah, he says. In Luke 17:26 says the same thing. And it talks, as in the days of Noah, so it will be in the days of the Son of Man. Verse 28 says, likewise also in the days of Lot, he says. Verse 29, on the very day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone down and destroyed them all. Even so it will be in the day the Son of Man will be revealed. Yes, the very day God will remove the believers, and then judgment will start. That's why it's a pre-tribulation rapture. You see, the point Jesus is making is that believers must be removed before the judgment, because Jesus, by his blood, has delivered us from the judgment. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, this is good news. This is good news. Rejoice. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 is a wonderful passage about the rapture. Verse 13, he says, "I don't want you to be ignorant." That's why I'm teaching you these things today, because God does not want you to be ignorant about the rapture. "Brethren, concerning those who've fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means go before those who are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout." Hallelujah, it'll be a shout to raise the dead. "And with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air." Hallelujah. "And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words." Now, you're very familiar with that passage, maybe. But I want you to notice, as we read into chapter 5, the subject has not changed. He's still talking about the rapture. And so just because man has made a chapter break here does not mean Paul has decided to talk about something else. Now let's read chapter 5 with this in mind, that we're talking about the rapture. "But concerning the times and seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write to you. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord, the tribulation, will come, or it will start as a thief in the night." It's going to start with the rapture, you see. Praise God. "For the world, the day of the Lord will be like a thief in the night, and then it will be plunged into the tribulation." And as we read on now, I want you to notice the contrast between, he talks about you and us believers, and they, the others, the unbelievers. And the destiny of these two groups of people is completely different at the rapture in the tribulation. Verse 2, "For you yourselves know," you know, you believers know, "perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say," that's the world, "says peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them." Not on the believers, but on them, you see, "as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they," unbelievers, "shall not escape. But true Christians have a different destiny. Verse 4. But you, brethren, you see, you are not in darkness, so that this day the tribulation should overtake you as a thief. You see, our experience will not be as the Lord as a thief in the night, because he will take us. For us, it's the bridegroom coming to take his bride. We have a different destiny, you see. Verse 5, why? You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. We don't belong to the tribulation, a time of darkness and judgment. We are sons of the light. We're born again. We're citizens of heaven. We belong with Jesus. Hallelujah. So we should be ready and alert and ready for takeoff. Verse 6, therefore let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. Verse 8, but let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. What's the salvation he's talking about? It's the rapture. In the rapture, we'll be saved. Our body will be resurrected. Hallelujah. And also, praise God, we'll be saved from the wrath, the judgment of God that's coming upon the earth at that time. Hallelujah. And it says that as a helmet, we should put on the helmet, which is the hope of our salvation in the rapture. Our thoughts should be covered with the confident expectation that Jesus is coming to take us to be with him. Hallelujah. And so rather than being afraid of the tribulation, praise God, we need to know, have the hope of our salvation in the rapture. Verse 9 says, why? Because God did not appoint us to wrath. See, believers are not appointed for the wrath of the tribulation, but instead to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. What salvation? It's the rapture. You see, the world has an appointment with wrath. But instead of that appointment, we will obtain salvation. We will be raptured. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yes, this salvation is the rapture, verse 10, because he says Jesus died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. He's saying in the rapture, we'll be made alive together with him, and we'll have that experience rather than this appointment with wrath. Therefore, comfort one another and edify one another just as you're doing. Hallelujah. Let me ask you these questions as we close. Would God allow his church to go through the time of worldwide judgment? Or will he deliver them like he did Noah and Lot? When God declares war on the Antichrist and his world system, will he not first pull out his ambassadors? Would a loving husband put his bride through hell just before the wedding? Some say we got to go through the tribulation to be purified by suffering. But this is like the heresy of purgatory. This would mean that our salvation through the blood of Jesus isn't enough. But we need the Antichrist to finish off the job. No. And if that was the case, those who have already died will miss out on this purification. Let me ask you, would Christ, the Lord, subject his own body, therefore himself, to his own wrath? No. Jesus is coming at any time. Are you ready? You need to get ready by receiving Christ as your Lord and Savior, and then proving that you have genuine faith by showing it in your life. Well, praise God.